Gosh, is anyone else feeling unseasonably warm? Like, 30 degrees too warm, because I'm absolutely melting.
You wouldn't think that temperatures could jump by as much as 30 degrees in just a few hours, but there's a kind of wind that can do just that. And in Antarctica, they can have extreme consequences. This video is about Föhn. Not to be confused with Föhn or Föhn, Föhn winds are hot, dry winds that occur when air is forced over a steep barrier. it's actually pronounced Föhn. Oh, yeah, and the most tangible thing that I took away from my trip to Berlin at the start of the year was the proper way to pronounce this word. It's only taken me 8 years of working on them. Yeah, Föhn, like Döner, except the winds are dry because they come without sauce. Right. If you've ever been to the Alps, the Andes, or any other big mountain range, you might have experienced these winds yourself. They can raise temperatures by as much as 30 degrees Celsius in just a few hours, making them a bit of a nightmare for skiers. Their name in the Rockies, Chinook, means snow eater, and in German, the word means hairdryer. So you can probably guess why Föhn winds in the Antarctic might be a bit of a problem over ice. Before we get to that, let's talk about where these winds come from. Föhn can happen anywhere with steep terrain, but they're really common on the Antarctic Peninsula. The peninsula has a long, high range of mountains right down its length. It separates the relatively warmer, more maritime climate of the west from the cold continental climate of the east. And because the winds often blow from west to east in this part of the world, we also frequently get Föhn winds on the eastern side, which can raise temperatures over the floating ice shelves. Föhn are formed when air is confronted with a high mountain barrier.
Can't go under it, can't go around it, got to go over it.
And what often happens is this. Moist air is forced over the mountains. As it rises, the air pressure drops and it gets colder and colder, just like if you were climbing the mountain yourself. Then, at a certain point, the moisture in the air condenses into a cloud and dumps a load of snow over the mountains, or rain if it's warm enough. When it flows down the other side of the mountain, the air is drier because it lost all of its moisture when it snowed. But also, it starts to heat up again as it descends because the atmospheric pressure is rising again. That heating is caused by the same process that makes a bike tire valve heat up as you inflate it and feel cold as you let the air out. This effect can raise temperatures massively during Föhn events. In Antarctica, it can be enough to bring temperatures up to the melting point of ice, even in the depths of winter. Pretty extreme, right? And Föhn winds often drive melting over ice shelves, especially in summer. Some work I did a few years ago showed that they were one of the main drivers of surface melting over the Larsen Sea ice shelf. We see a pattern in satellite pictures of melting that smacks of the influence of Föhn winds. The heating from these hairdryer winds melts snow and ice, causing meltwater to collect in puddles and lakes on the surface. If this happens often enough and there's not enough snow to replenish the ice shelf, it can become so weak that it can collapse. After many years and decades of melting and weakening, Föhn winds can be the straw that breaks the camel's back. And in fact, that's exactly what happened in 1995 when the Larsen A ice shelf collapsed, and then again in 2002 when Larsen B, its bigger, colder sibling, followed suit. Essentially, climate change creates the conditions for collapse. Extreme heating from Föhn winds, for example, acts as the trigger. We've seen that hairdryer winds can cause really big temperature jumps. In fact, the highest temperature ever recorded on the Antarctic continent, a massive 18.3 degrees Celsius at Esperanza on the Northern Peninsula in February 2020, was associated with a Föhn wind. And Föhn are very often behind extreme temperatures, but they also often combine with other extreme events like atmospheric rivers, which I covered in this video up here. In fact, that's exactly what happened during the collapse of Larsen B. When two types of extremes combine, they can cause pretty crazy things to happen, from sea ice breakup to glacier melt to the collapse of entire ice shelves. And while individual extreme events aren't necessarily disastrous by themselves, when we start seeing more and more of them over time, that's when it starts to become a problem. And unfortunately, climate change means that we're seeing more extreme events in Antarctica every single year, with dramatic consequences for the continent and for the rest of us. Warmer average temperatures mean extremes are getting hotter too. And although the frequency of Föhn winds may not change much, those warmer temperatures can have a greater impact. A warmer average climate means hairdryer winds can drive temperatures up to the melting point more often, making ice shelf destabilization more likely. And when ice shelves collapse, they can indirectly contribute to sea level rise by allowing glaciers to flow unrestricted into the sea. Föhn winds and other extreme events are always going to be a feature of our climate. That's the nature of our beautiful, chaotic planet. But as we push it further and further into uncharted territory, the impacts of those extremes are getting more severe. The only way to avoid more irreversible changes in the polar environment is to prioritize a transition to a greener future, cut emissions of greenhouse gases, and adapt to the future that is already in store. Thanks as ever to my Patreon gang for your support. If you're not one of them and you want in, you can sign up to help me make even better videos over here. And if you want to hear more about how extremes are reshaping our coldest continent, check out this video over here. Ciao for now.